In the year 97 of the Common Era, a man stood on the shore of the Persian Gulf and considered his next step. He had traveled a long way through many lands, and he was close to achieving his goal. But the Parthian sailors he was speaking to were not encouraging. "The ocean is huge," they said. "Those making the round trip can do it in 3 months if the winds are favorable. However, if you encounter winds that delay you, it can take 2 years. That is why all the men who go by sea take stores for 3 years. The vast ocean urges men to think of their country and get homesick, and some of them die." The sailors were not being quite honest. While bad weather can delay a trip, 3 years is quite a tall tale, even for a voyage using first-century sailing boats. But the man had no way of knowing that, and he was swayed by their arguments. It is not recorded whether he felt sad that he was unable to reach his destination, or relief that he could give a good excuse for abandoning his quest. In any case, he turned for home, and made his report concerning all the things he had seen on his journey. His name was Gan Ying, and he was an official of the court of the Han Emperor. His ultimate destination, never quite attained, was the mysterious and exotic capital city of the great empire of the far west, Da Qin, Imperial Rome. Gan Ying's report of his journey, now only surviving in fragments, is one of the earliest written records we have of the route that carried luxury goods back and forth across the great supercontinent of Eurasia. But the route he traveled, part of a vast web of roads and trading posts that spanned the landmass between the Pacific Ocean and the Straits of Gibraltar, was ancient even to him. Long before Rome was founded, before the Han Dynasty was ever conceived, in the days when Minoan Crete was flourishing and the great stones of Stonehenge were being set in their place on the far-off island of Britain, valuable goods were already passing back and forth between the mountains and plains of Central and East Asia and the shores of the Mediterranean Sea. One of the earliest traceable materials traded along those routes was a deep blue stone flecked with gold, lapis lazuli, much sought after among the elite of the Neolithic and Bronze Age Mediterranean powers. Mined in the mountains of what is now Afghanistan, lapis lazuli was still being traded out of Central Asia in the late Middle Ages, and its distant origin is what gave its name to the rich blue pigment it created, beloved of medieval European painters, a name still used today, ultramarine, ultramarina, the color from across the sea. As technology changed and tools began to be made from metal as well as stone, another commodity from Central Asia became critical, tin, an essential component, along with copper, of the bronze that gave its name to the age. Copper is a relatively common metal, but tin is rare, and the mines in the same hills that produced lapis lazuli supplied tin to the nations around the Mediterranean and to those of Asia. In exchange, the Mediterranean traders offered grain, gold, silver, ivory, wool, amber, salt, wine, and slaves. Some of those things came to the Mediterranean from even further west. Gold, ivory, and salt from Western and Northern Africa, wool and amber from Northern Europe, and slaves, of course, from anywhere they could be taken. Some things came from closer to the Mediterranean Sea, wine and grain in particular. And then came silk. Production of silk in China can be traced as far back as the Neolithic period, and the earliest surviving silk textile we have comes from the tomb of a child near Xinyang in Henan and has been dated to 3630 BCE. It became a highly desirable textile almost immediately, The earliest evidence we have for long-distance trade in the fabric is traces of silk found in the hair of an Egyptian mummy of the 21st dynasty, around 1070 BCE. By the 4th century BCE, Greece and Rome knew about the nation they called the Silk People. And by the 1st century CE, around the time that Gan Ying turned around and went home, Rome was spending an astonishing amount of money on silk. Enough that the Emperor Tiberius passed sumptuary laws forbidding men from wearing the fabric. These laws had little effect. The Roman craving for silk was such that an entire secondary industry developed in Rome. Merchants would hire weavers to unravel the imported fabric and remake it with a looser weave, in order to enlarge the fabric and increase their profits. This had the side effect of making the fabric transparent, and the writer Seneca the Younger complained, "I see clothes of silk, if materials that do not hide the body, nor even one's decency, can be called clothes. Wretched flocks of maids labor so that the adulteress may be visible through her thin dress, so that her husband has no more acquaintance than any outsider or foreigner with his wife's body." The moralists had no more effect on the consumption of silk than the laws had, and Roman expenditures on silk continued unabated. The emperors of China did their level best to keep the secret of silk production within their own country. But by the 6th century, the Byzantine Empire had obtained smuggled silkworm eggs and began to produce its own silk, mostly for imperial use. By the 11th century, a silk industry was active in Italy. Silk from China was still regarded as superior in quality for a long time, but Constantinople and Lucca became responsible for a great deal of European silk production. And what did the Chinese trade their silk for? Horses. The horses of the Eurasian steppe, bred by the pastoralist nomads who lived there, were the most desired commodity sought by the various dynasties and kingdoms of China, especially the horses of the Fergana Valley in Uzbekistan. The need for good quality horses for the army would, from time to time, nearly bankrupt the Tang, Song, and Ming dynasties. The Chinese traded silk and tea to the Turkic and Mongolian peoples of Northern and Central Asia who bred the best horses, and they in turn traded that silk and tea westward for other luxuries and staples. Not all of the commodities that traveled from east to west came overland from China, of course. Some came by sea, from further south. Spices, for example. Cloves, nutmeg, black pepper, long pepper, cinnamon, cardamom, and ginger all came from the Indonesian archipelago and were carried north to China and west to India and beyond. Likewise, incense, especially frankincense and myrrh, came north into the Silk Routes from southern Arabia. The resins of two trees native to the southern end of the Arabian Peninsula, incense was an important part of religious rites all around the Mediterranean Sea. The incense trade was carried overland by Nabataean traders based in the great stone city of Petra until the 1st century of the Common Era, when Roman shipping down the coast of Arabia overtook the land routes. There were things that went west to east as well. In addition to the fine horses of the Fergana Valley, China had a taste for wool, glass, and gold. A tomb in Guangzhou, dated to the 1st century BCE, contains a Roman glassware bowl. Roman glassware has also been found in a 5th century tomb in Korea. Gan Ying's account of the riches of Rome, probably gathered secondhand from his Parthian contacts, makes reference to gold, silver, gems of all kinds, gold thread embroidery, perfumes, and asbestos fabric. Gold came mostly from Africa. While there are deposits of gold all over the globe, in the pre-modern period, much of the world's gold supply came from the mines in the west of Africa. By the 5th century CE, gold was being transported across the Sahara to the eastern Mediterranean, along with slaves and salt. How much gold did Western Africa have? The tale of Mansa Musa, king of Mali in the early 14th century, is illuminating. In 1324, Musa went on pilgrimage to Mecca, taking with him an enormous entourage and an equally enormous supply of gold. Taking seriously the instruction to give alms, Musa generously gave away vast quantities of his gold as gifts in Cairo, so much that he accidentally depressed the value of the metal. On his return journey, learning of the disaster he had created, he borrowed back much of the money he had given out in order to stabilize the economy. This effort appears to have been successful. Upon his return to Mali, however, he repaid the loans in a single gigantic lump sum, which had the effect of devaluing the metal once again. He is perhaps the only person in history to crash an economy by means of casual charity, to restore it by the same means, and then crash it a second time by being a responsible borrower. Mansa Musa's pilgrimage to Mecca highlights another aspect of the Silk Routes. It was not only goods and people that traveled across the continents. Ideas did too. Timbuktu is a long way from Mecca, but Musa was a faithful adherent of a religion that had its origins in the Arabian Peninsula. Islam was founded in the early 7th century and probably reached Mali by the 11th century. By the year 1300, all the kings of Mali were Muslim. At the same time, Islam spread eastwards as well, reaching China soon after its foundation in the 7th century. By the 10th century, many of the Turkic-speaking regions around China were predominantly Muslim. Other religions traveled as well. By the year 635 CE, Nestorian Christians had arrived in China, and the first church building in China, in Lo Guan Tai, has been dated to 638 CE. By the 14th century, there may have been as many as 700,000 Christians in China. Judaism came too. In the early Song Dynasty, sometime after the year 960, a small Jewish community developed in the city of Dongjing, now called Kaifeng. In 1163, they built a synagogue in the heart of the city, and the community prospered well into the 17th century. The earliest religion to travel along the Silk Routes was Buddhism, which reached China from India sometime between the 2nd century BCE and the 3rd century CE. Initially poorly received by Confucian scholars and commonly mixed up with aspects of Taoism, careful work by Parthian and Kuchan missionaries eventually made it a respectable part of Han society. Buddhism traveled west too, although not in the form you might expect. A 4th century version of the story of how Siddhartha Gautama became the Buddha, having reached Baghdad in a Manichaean text via Persia, was translated into Arabic in the 8th century, where it was introduced to Arabic Christians. They eventually passed it along to their European contacts, and in the late 10th century, a Georgian monk translated it into Greek. In the mid-11th century, it was translated into Latin in Constantinople. By this time, a great many changes had been made to the story. The Sanskrit word bodhisattva became the Persian bodhisav, which became buddhasav or yudasav in Arabic, which became yodasav in the Georgian text, adapted as yoasav into Greek, finally emerging in the Latin text as yosapat in the tale of Balaam and Yosapat, in which the Buddha appears in the form of an early Christian hermit. Along with religion, learning traveled too. When Mansa Musa returned from his pilgrimage to Mecca, he brought with him, along with his careless approach to macroeconomics, a host of architects and scholars from all the places he had visited. With their assistance, he founded mosques and schools in his capital city of Timbuktu. These institutions came to be highly regarded as places of scholarship across the Muslim world. Students could study geography, astronomy, medicine, and, remarkably, history, even though history was an unusual subject at Muslim schools at this time. At one point, it was estimated that nearly 25,000 people, almost a quarter of the population of Timbuktu, then estimated at 100,000, were students. The number of private libraries in the city was also astonishing. Despite the decline of the city in later years, it is estimated that some 700,000 manuscripts copied in Timbuktu still survive, preserving texts on art, medicine, philosophy, and science, in scholarly Arabic as well as in the local languages of Songhai and Tamashek. There is much less information available about the state of learning at the other end of the trade routes. China in particular was reluctant to depart from Confucian scholarship, but there must have been a robust and broad tradition of scholarship across Central Asia. The great scholar Abu Ali ibn Sina, known to Europe as Avicenna, was born in the late 10th century in Bukhara, in what is now Uzbekistan, at that time under the rule of the Persian Samanid dynasty, into an intellectual culture commonly referred to as the Islamic Golden Age, when Greco-Roman philosophical texts were being brought into contact with Persian and Indian mathematical texts, and fused with current understandings of astronomy, algebra, trigonometry, and medicine. Ibn Sina's own five-volume medical encyclopedia, The Canon of Medicine, remained one of the standard texts in medicine in the Islamic world and Europe until the 18th century. One of the things that seems remarkable now about the Silk Routes is that, despite the quantities of goods, ideas, and people that traveled them, very few people made the full journey of some 6,500 kilometers. Most of the trade was regional. A merchant in Chang'an might travel only as far as Anxi on the eastern end of the Taklamakan Desert, where he would sell it to a Tokharian merchant who would carry it to the western end of the Taklamakan and sell it to a Sogdian merchant who would carry it perhaps only as far as Kokand on the northern branch or Kabul on the southern branch, where he in turn would sell it to a Persian or Bactrian merchant who might carry it only as far as Nishapur, and so on. For Mansa Musa to travel from Timbuktu to Mecca, or for Gan Ying to go from Chang'an to the Persian Gulf, was highly unusual. Even this regional type of trade was not exactly easy. Today, with paved roads and fast vehicles, we think little of traveling a few hundred kilometers in a day. A well-organized caravan might travel only 30 or 40 kilometers in a day, or less if the terrain was bad or if something interfered with orderly operation. A recalcitrant camel, an argument among the drivers, an encounter with another caravan, anxiety about bandits. Anything could slow progress, and few things could speed it up. And because of the distance, it wasn't possible for a caravan to carry everything it needed. Water and food were necessities that mostly had to be purchased on the way, which meant regular stops in communities along the route. The needs of the caravans created logistical problems for the communities where they stopped as well. The need to accommodate large numbers of travelers, strangers to the area, could create tensions within the community. The solution adopted almost all the way along the various routes was the caravanserai, a hostel, often quite large and elaborate, located just outside the town, with secure accommodation for the drivers and their animals, protected by the local authorities, and providing food, water, and rest, as well as access to the market, without requiring the travelers to enter the town proper. Many of these caravanserais became markets themselves, removing the need for the traveling merchants to enter the town at all. There was often a tax imposed by local authorities on the goods traveling through their territories, and the benefits of the trading and taxation were enough that at least some effort was made to ensure that between stops, the caravans could travel safely without fear of bandits. At the height of the Mongol and Timurid empires, from the early 13th to the early 15th centuries, the political stability they created helped to make the Silk Routes trade flourish as never before. When these empires fractured in the mid-15th century, they were no longer able to ensure the safety of the trade routes, which became less lucrative as they became more dangerous. The rise of the Ottoman Empire also disrupted East-West trade, and prompted European countries to seek alternative routes, mostly maritime, to reach the countries that supplied them with their beloved silk and spices. With the shift to travel by sea in the 16th century, driven by the development of the carrack and other large ocean-going ships capable of traveling around the Horn of Africa, the great land routes declined and lost much of their economic importance except for more local trade. The great trading posts of Central Asia, like Bukhara, Kandahar, Kashgar, and Dunhuang, lost their importance and shrank to small regional administrative centers. But I would like to end not with the fading of these great trade networks, but with a description of one of the most famous cities along the Silk Routes. In the first decade of the 15th century, Enrique III of Castile sent ambassadors to the court of the Turco-Mongolian ruler Timur, founder of what would become known as the Timurid Empire, who was better known in Europe as Tamerlane. Ruy González de Clavijo wrote a marvelous account of his journey through Central Asia and of the court of Timur, and particularly of the great city of Samarqand, Timur's new capital, in what is now southeastern Uzbekistan. González de Clavijo's account is a remarkable look at a city that was being transformed from a trading post into the capital of an empire. Every year to the city of Samarqand, much merchandise of all kinds came from Cathay, India, Tartary, and from many other quarters besides. For in the countries around the Samarqand territory, commerce is very flourishing. But there was as yet no place within the city where this merchandise might be suitably stored, displayed, and offered for sale. Timur therefore now gave orders that a street should be built to pass right through Samarqand, which should have shops opened on either side of it, in which every kind of merchandise should be sold. And this new street was to go from one side of the city through to the other side, traversing the heart of the township. No sooner had all the houses been thrown down than the master builders came and laid out the broad new street, erecting shops on the one side and opposite, placing before each a high stone bench that was topped with white slabs. Each shop had two chambers, front and back, and the streetway was arched over with a domed roof in which were windows to let the light through. As soon as these shops were made ready, forthwith they were occupied by merchants selling goods of all sorts, and at intervals down the street were erected water fountains. The masons who worked through the day at nightfall went home, their places being taken by as many as had gone, who worked through the night hours. Thus, in the course of 20 days, the whole new street was carried through, a wonder indeed to behold. Can you imagine what it must have been like for travelers to come through the wild valleys that lead south from the dry steppes, past the caravanserais outside the city, under the gates, and into the great central street of Samarqand, the shops shaded by the arching roof of the street, water sparkling in the fountains, with the voices of the merchants and their customers mingling in the air, selling spices, wine, grain, silver and gold and ironwork, woolen cloth, and, of course, the great bolts of shimmering silk in every color under heaven, while outside the far gate, the great trains of camels loaded with goods set off along the next stage of that great network of roads, carrying with them all the riches of the world. This video is presented as part of the Silk Routes 2023 conference, organized by Costumers of Color on YouTube. There are many more excellent presentations that you should be sure not to miss. You can find them at costumersofcolor.org or by searching hashtag SilkRoutes2023 on YouTube and social media. A link to the list of events is in the video description. My thanks to the organizers of this event, especially Gigi at Costumers of Color, for supporting and encouraging me. No presentation of this kind can be done in a vacuum, and in particular, I owe a debt of gratitude to Christian Cameron, who shared his extensive library with me, tracked down references to silk and horses, maritime routes, and Central Asian cities, and put up with my endless ramblings about geography, technology, and ancient economics. And to Joyce Tan, who kept me from making a complete fool of myself when pronouncing Chinese names. If you are interested in learning more about the things I have mentioned here, you can find a general bibliography in the video description. The Silk Routes are a fascinating cultural and economic phenomenon, and I encourage you to dig deeper. Thank you for listening.